Today on Man Up America, Mitch wore all black to an all-black studio, so she's like a floating head. In the meantime, guess what? Guess what?
You're rocking your sweater vest.
I'm rocking the sweater vest, which automatically means I am the most important and smart person in the room. You're listening to Man Up America.
The DJ accepts no responsibility for the next record.
Say what?
Oh no, he's there.
Where's my money, man? Where's my money?
It's time to Man Up America.
Let's do this.
It is that magical day called Tuesday.
No.
It's one away from hump day, but still three away from the weekend. I'm the good Dr. Jay Adam here on Talk 101.3 The Buzz, WTNB Television. I've got Mitch in the studio.
How are ya?
I'm doing fine.
Yeah?
People are tuning in to see you now, to see the floating head. You can find that on WTNB Television, Charter Channel 5, Comcast 210, Digital TV dial 27.1, or we're Facebook Living on the Man Up America page, facebook.com/manuptalk, facebook.com/manuptalk. All right, Mitch, it's been a long weekend, and like always, when we come back from a long weekend, there's a lot of headlines to hit.
Yeah.
So, did you birth any more goats, bats, whatever?
No.
Okay, good. So, we can get straight to the headlines.
Right.
What I did this weekend is something that I like doing.
Okay.
I got to coach again.
Yeah.
So, I've transitioned from my oldest son, who's now in middle school, to where I began coaching flag football for my youngest son, who's in kindergarten. So, I've got a team full of pre-K to two second graders. Trying to teach them flag football. Mm-hmm. And I can only imagine that in many ways the halls of Congress function
that's
the
like,
same way.
Right. No, that makes a lot of sense, actually.
I was sitting there and I'm going, this must be what it's like to try to be a whip in Congress or something like that.
Right.
So, I started coaching the kids again. My youngest son is very different than my oldest son, and that's an adjustment for me. But they're really cute. It'll remain to be seen whether or not we win a ball game.
Do you win? Is there winning and losing?
Oh, there's always. If I'm coaching and my kids are playing in it, there's a winner and a loser.
Okay. My kids
are in athletics for the comprehensive nature of what they learn through that process.
Yes.
Being not only do they learn teamwork and effort and all those fun things, but they learn that in the real world, sometimes you win and sometimes you lose.
Right.
And losing should feel bad and winning should feel good.
Right. Yeah.
Okay.
That's good. That's good.
They are not consequence fluid. Like so many people want to be.
Right.
So no, we don't do upward sports. Nothing against you guys that want to do upward.
Right.
I actually tried to use upward for my daughter, who's not a bit athletic, because I felt if she did upward, she would be more comfortable in that setting. But I have a competitive son.
Yeah.
He fits in the competitive environment. And like I said, they are not consequence fluid.
Yeah.
There are winners, there are losers, just like there are boys and there are girls.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
Let the hate mail commence. Yeah. Facebook.com/manuptalk.
You know, Boogs writes on the bottom of her trophies, if it's not like a first or a second place trophy, she'll take a Sharpie and write on the bottom, PA.
What does that mean?
Participation award.
Oh, really?
So, yeah. Yeah.
So your daughter's very judgmental for a 9-year-old.
She's absolutely.
I wonder where she gets that from.
No.
You have no clue where she gets that from.
No, not at all.
All right, we're going to jump in today. Like we got a lot to cover, lots of headlines. Been a long weekend. There is much ado about everything in this community. So, without any further ado, here we go. All right, Mitch, here we are. It's Tuesday. Headlines are rolling. We've got some big ones. We're going to cover gas tax in Tennessee. We're going to cover overhaul of Obamacare, UTK Twitter policy. Don't lose your scholarship over Twitter.
Right.
We're talking about the socials up in here on WTNB and Talk 101.3 The Buzz. But we will start with the new immigration order that came out of the Trump administration.
Right.
Mitch, tell us just exactly what is different this go around.
Well, there are actually a few things that are different. Lots that were the same, lots of just different tweaking on the language and using a little bit of, I guess, less judgmental wording.
So you're saying the tone is different.
The tone is very different.
Okay, besides the tone, what is different about this?
So we're no longer including Iraq in this ban. It's narrowed down to 6 countries rather than 7.
Okay.
So they're gone.
Now, why are we not including Iraq?
Well, they say that...
Who is they?
New York lawfareblog.com.
Okay, which is, we know, is not fake news.
Right?
Right? I don't know. Okay, no, but it's a good summary.
Right.
Okay.
So they're saying that the U.S. and Iraqi governments have reached an agreement about what the screening process needs to look like in order for people to travel to here from there. So it sounds like there was some good dialogue.
So back
there
to the kind of original intent of why we had this whole fiasco to begin with is... countries were identified both by the Obama administration and the Trump administration as having insufficient screening process.
Right.
So you're telling me Iraq is now up to standard.
All compliant.
How's that whole clean water thing going over there?
You know,
is that up to standard yet?
I think that probably I don't necessarily know how all of a sudden – it would be interesting to see why all of a sudden we feel like, well, maybe – and maybe it was just a compliance issue. Maybe they have agreed to go ahead and say, all right, we'll go ahead and screen people. And other people aren't quite as willing to comply, but
I haven't drilled down yet into just exactly what – the Iraqis have done that satisfied the Trump administration. I haven't gotten that deep yet with this immigration order. I did notice that the Iraqis rolled off the books. I can't help but think, if you'll remember, there was some criticism with the initial order because some people who were kind of seeking sanctuary, who had been, you know, informants for our military, a lot of those were Iraqis.
The translators,
lot of those were Iraqi. So I can't help but think there's a little bit of politics on the backside of this with Iraq and what's taking place with those folks. But there was another big substantive change, which is pretty monumental when it comes to the legal situation the Trump administration faced with their first order.
Right. So they're saying that there's no – it does not single out Syrians. There is no indefinite Syrian ban now. We're not, it says eliminates any preference for religious minorities.
Okay, so this kind of hits the folks who say this is, and even Nancy Pelosi said it's still immoral.
Right.
It's still targeting Muslims, despite the fact that it, you can't target Muslims. It's in the order. You can't target Muslims. It has to be country specific, although they're saying it's still a Muslim target. I'm sure there's an argument one way or the other. But the key one I'm looking for is if you had a visa.
If you had a visa, you're good to go.
You still have a visa.
You're good to go.
So
if you have applied for a visa and that's already been, you know, pushed through, then that's not going to kick back. If you were a refugee that already had paperwork in motion before this was signed, that does not get kicked back. You know, this is it opens the door for, like you said, our translators to come through. And it actually does say that this gives Homeland Security and the Secretary of State to judge this on a case-by-case basis. So if there is someone seeking sanctuary in the United States from one of the banned countries, that can be looked at from a case-by-case basis and just really judge it for what it is and see if this person is
So it's kind of like an appeals process.
Right.
You can apply for exception.
It said that the most noticeably toned down language was that it eliminated the section describing the people as those who would place violent ideologies over American law. So that's gone.
Okay.
So we really toned it down.
Is that a slap at Sharia?
I would assume that, yeah, that's okay. probably that a big slap at Sharia.
All right, so big summary, 10,000-foot view for all of our viewers and listeners. Trump has changed it. He has modified the elements that people criticize. Now, I'm actually going to give the Trump administration a little bit of credit here, much to the chagrin of our liberal listeners and viewers. The process of policy should be, here's what I propose. Arguably, his implementation of what he proposed was premature, and that's why the courts pulled back on it. People say, well, here's what I see is the problem, and then you modify. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me that a lot of what he's modified were the criticisms that people had with the policy. Now, we know that Donald Trump could issue an order tomorrow to feed 5 hungry children ice cream, and Nancy Pelosi and some people are going to come out and talk about how he's making America fat again.
Right, right. So or only five.
Yeah, that's
or
right. How or there's did only he pick? Five. How did he pick these five children? Uh-huh. All of these children are just, you know, if they were all white, he's only doing it for white children. If they were minorities, he's picking token minorities.
Yes.
There's going to be those folks that he can do no right.
Right.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
Just like there are those folks he can do no wrong.
Sure.
All right? We put those folks in camps, and we point and laugh at them, but reasonable policy should be the process of here's what we propose, here's what's wrong with it. All right, we debate it back and forth. Here's what we fix. This is exactly what this new order is.
It is.
It's a fix.
Mm-hmm.
Is
mm-hmm.
it a complete fix? Well, it depends on who you talk to. There are people who are obviously still upset with it. There are people mm-hmm. who want no immigration ban at all.
Yeah.
And they're not going to be satisfied unless there's no immigration
right.
ban at all. And I got news for you. If you're a no immigration banner, there are just as many people the other side of the equation, who want to ban everybody from this
all
country.
Immigration,
want
yeah.
to build the wall higher and taller and put mm-hmm. electricity right. running through it. And they want to put it on the Canadian border, too. So you've got the polarity, but the reasonable people in the middle say, all right, how do we target? If we're really looking at foreign countries that have inadequate screening processes that could render people with ill intent.
Right.
If it's the most open door, how do we shut that door? This is at least an attempt.
Sure.
I personally still don't know if it's something I'm okay with. I'm still that bring me, you're tired, you're hungry, you're poor.
Right.
But, again, I was okay with a pause, and this is still a 90-day.
This is still a 90-day pause.
It's still a 90-day pause.
And this actually, they gave more leadway into when this takes effect. This didn't take effect immediately. I believe it takes effect on
March
16th. So that way we're not dealing with crisis in airports again and mass chaos. So I think that they did take some steps to think this one through this time mm-hmm. and think about, all right, this is it for us. We have to do this one right and approach it correctly. And so it's perceived correctly. Openly and less hostile from the public if we ever want to get anywhere with this. So I like it. I'd like to know.
It is improvement. I think any reasonable person can say it's improvement.
Right.
Now,
you're
going to
have the
alts are gonna
on
say,
both sides.
Well, that's improvement, like taking chemo for cancer is improvement. I get it, guys.
Well,
I get it. I get how you feel about it. Again, the process of policy, give and take, this is at least one of those situations.
Right.
So coming more local.
Yeah.
We have our own little fiasco here in Tennessee with our gas tax.
Yay.
We mentioned last week that the proposal the governor had put forth in his bill or his act, which was Tennessee bill act. It'll change names three times.
Right. Vision or something.
Okay.
I don't know.
So it'll go. It came out of subcommittee with the amendment that removed the gas tax. Now, everybody says, regardless of how you feel about the proposal, the proposal doesn't work unless you have the revenue from the gas tax. That's
right.
not going to stay. That amendment that came out of the House Finance Subcommittee that stripped it of the gas tax privilege, it's just not going to work.
Right.
It's going to wind up
right.
back in there during the Transportation
sure.
Committee. So the big controversy here is here on a local level, you have Thunder Dan Rawls, county commissioner out of the 6th District, who was in Nashville last week, who brought to the Bradley County Commission a proposal to where they would speak in voice against the gas tax.
Right.
Five commissioners voted for that proposal, saying no gas tax. The rest voted against. Most of the commissioners voting against said, I don't think this is something we speak on. One was really wise, and this is really the truth. I don't care who you are. They said, if we speak out against this, we could experience retaliation when it comes to funding projects. And that's absolutely true.
Right.
And if you don't think that this governor or any other governor in the history of humanity doesn't retaliate, look no further than Chris Christie and the bridge.
Right.
Right.
Okay. Right. Right.
So governors retaliate. That is a rational fear to have when you're a local legislator, because keep in mind, local governing bodies are a subsidiary of the state. The state is the sovereign power. Hear that, federal government? The state is the sovereign power. But they're the sovereign power when it comes to the other way, right? Local
right,
up.
Right.
So Thunder Dan Rawls goes on the commission and says, we want to vote against this this tax. Five of them voted to say no. The rest voted to not say no, which didn't necessarily mean say yes, but
right,
several of them said.
Right.
Here's my 2 cents. Now, when I was on the county commission, I said in commission meetings, it is appropriate for the governing body that represents a community, like Bradley County, to speak on behalf of the county. Director of schools, we voted to the state supporting the idea of having an elected director of schools.
Right.
It was a state decision. It was not a local decision. However, here's where I drew my line, and this is going to put me at odds, and I'm friends with Thunder Dan, but this is going to put me at odds with Dan a little bit. I tried to ask myself, if I'm asking the state to do something, if I am being a voice for the people, is there something actionable for us at the local level that comes by voicing this?
Right.
So like with an elected director of schools, had the state listened to us and passed that provision, it would have come back to the county commission and it would have been our decision through a vote,
right,
a two-thirds vote, to allow an elected director of schools. So there was some sort of power, something we were asking
right
for.
Mm-hmm.
With this gas tax thing, there's not anything the county's really asking for. Now, I'll be honest, one time we voted about salaries for TVA and how we said you gave them a bunch of big salaries and yet you gave our residents a rate increase. So it's the same, and I'll be honest with you, in that vote, I voted yay, you know, to the voice of the people is they don't like these rate increases, and here you are giving people a bunch of
right
big salaries. But in hindsight, I don't know if I would have done that again, because I think we have to look at the idea of, am I asking the state to do something that as a commission furthers our ability to do something?
Right.
And so I'm sympathetic to the commissioners. Now, Thunder Dan, I heard you on a Midday Buzz today.
Uh-oh.
You said shame on those commissioners. I'm not going to say shame on those commissioners.
Right.
I understand their fear of retaliation,
mm-hmm,
because it's real. And we've
right
got a project in Highway 60 out your
right
way,
mm-hmm,
that desperately needs attention. We've
sure
got other things we need attention from in the state. And the veterans home's still up in the air, you know. We need the support of the state, so I understand the politics behind it.
Mm-hmm.
I also respect Dan for saying, listen, I'm a principled cat. Forget these politics. If there's retaliation, we're going to expose retaliation. We're going to take it head on. But the truth of the matter is, the governor's proposal is not going to happen without that gas tax increase.
Right.
So
right,
it's going to materialize again, folks. I recommend that you talk directly to your state legislators, both the Senate and the House. Dan mentioned, too, Thunder Dan. I call him Thunder Dan because he's such a powerful presence. He also mentioned, too, that several of the state reps were asking for the feedback from local communities on this issue, but they always do.
Right.
Anything they can produce. I love you, Kevin. I love you, Mike. Dan.
Anything
Todd,
that's justifiable to
anything
the cause.
Anything that they can produce, not only to give them some insight into what people say, but anything they can produce as kind of evidence to say, you know, but my people won't.
Right.
And a resolution really does that. There were times I forwarded resolutions about our voting machines. I sent
mm-hmm
that to the
mm-hmm
state level. There are times that we sent that to give them ammunition. So I understand that they ask for that, but they always ask for
mm-hmm
that. That's what
mm-hmm
they do.
Mm-hmm.
They ask for that ammunition. At the end of the day, I think it's everybody's responsibility. If you want to be heard on the issue of the gas tax, you need to contact your local representatives.
Sure.
And they're easy to find, Tennessee.gov. Go to the website. You can find their number.
Right.
Call them.
Before you do that, though, make sure you understand what it's all about. Understand what it's covering, what it's doing, what it's not doing. Educate yourself before you go
saying. And understand that there's a flip side to this, that there are cuts on the other side.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm
to destroy the whole bill, you're going to lose some very positive things, too. This is a tricky situation. I'm not necessarily jumping behind this gas tax because I'm skeptical of that it's going to accomplish what they say it's going to accomplish.
Right.
But we'll see. We'll see. If you've got your feedback, give it to your state reps.
Right.
We've had Kevin Brooks on this program. We've had Mike Bell interviewed on segments of this program. Right. So they're looking for your
vote. Is the general consensus here of the people of Bradley County? Are they for this? Are they not so liking this?
I would say, and you're this is complete speculation. Man up, it's complete speculation. I don't know. Average Joe on the ground's very against the gas tax. People who are in economic development are very pro.
Okay.
You know, so the people at the chamber are going to be very pro business, the Industrial Development Board, those people who kind of see and work with those
transportation
projects.
But the people that it hits them in the pocketbook, they're the ones that
are against. Everybody in the pocketbook, right? But I think the people who see the deterioration of infrastructure feel a bit more, I think they're welcome with any solution, and this is a solution that's in front of them, and it's one that possibly they could get.
Right.
So, moving on the flop. Let's hit the last one. We're going to save the UTK Twitter policy to tomorrow. But Obamacare overhaul. I said on this program, Mitch, I sat here and fussed for an hour one day about how somebody has to put forth a plan.
Yep.
So we have a plan.
Yes, we
have. Tell me what's in this
plan
and what changes with the House proposal to
repeal, replace, and keep.
Yeah.
So there's several things. All right, what we're keeping, I'm going to start with what's staying. You know, insurers cannot set a limit on what, under ACA, insurers cannot set a limit on what they were going to cover. You know, so that's staying.
So your pre-existing conditions are still there.
Your pre-existing conditions are staying.
Okay, before you continue further, let's talk real quick. And you and I, let's brainstorm. I'm going to make a little note here. Okay, so the big concerns were I need my pre-existing conditions covered, right?
Right, so that's covered. You're good to go.
All right. Another concern was, can my kids stay on?
Your kids are staying 26. On until they're 26. That's not going anywhere.
Okay, till 26. The other concern is premiums to come down.
Premiums, well, you know what they're saying is...
Well, we just don't know that,
right? We just don't know.
This is what people want. Let's see. So they want it because they want affordable coverage there.
Right.
What are some other things I'm missing that people wanted to see with ACA?
Well, they
and don't tell me that everybody's covered. What do you want to see for you in ACA?
Right. The ACA was, you know, 10 essential health benefits, like maternity leave and things like that.
So maternity leave.
Preventative services, talking about screenings, both male and female. That's all staying. That's all staying. So everything that was there in ACA, that's not going
anywhere.
And
we want the ability to not have to buy it.
Right.
Right?
Okay. Right.
So the ability to refuse.
Right. Right.
All right. So let's go through what's changing. So we've already checked off. We keep our pre-existing conditions.
Right.
You're going to be covered. What else?
Adult children can still stay on there.
All right. So that check.
Right. Right. Now, as far as premiums, that's where it gets...
We don't know. So question mark.
We don't know
question mark
on that, but we do know that it is giving a lot more power back to the people to choose. You're not going to be penalized for not buying insurance anymore.
Well, there's where we go. We don't know if premium costs are going to come down, but we do know that if you can refuse it...
You can refuse it.
That you can refuse levels of it to reduce your costs, right?
So exactly.
Well, I'm going to say we're a third of the way there on premiums.
Right. The new bill eliminates the individual mandate for people to have to buy
insurance. So you do not have to buy. Check.
Right.
All right. What about preventative care?
Preventative care, you have the option to, you know, you can buy in at certain levels. You can buy catastrophic care. You can buy a plan for preventative care.
So you decide. I'm going to put, you know, their preventative care's there if you want to pay for it.
Right.
Right? Once again, the control to the consumer. Okay,
yes.
Great. All right. What about maternity leave?
Maternity leave stays as it was in ACA.
Okay.
Exactly the way it was in ACA.
I'm going to give it a half for maternity leave.
Mm-hmm.
What about paternity leave?
I don't know about paternity leave. It says the 10 essential health care benefits, including maternity and preventative services. So I don't know. I think, is paternity leave lumped
into
maternity
leave? I don't know. We've got to find out. Maybe one of our viewers, maybe that really, really, that guy that thinks he knows everything that always comments. comment at facebook.com/menuptalk. Tell me, does it cover paternity leave? We got to dig down. This proposal came out when? Tail end of last week.
Right.
Yeah, okay, so
we've
got to do our research. We're hitting the high spots here.
But we're at least halfway there. Fun thing about this, good thing, some people might consider it good and bad, but this allows you to put a lot more money into a healthcare savings account
than the ACA. I am an HSA user.
Right.
I told you I actually birthed two children, not me myself, my wife did.
Right.
On a health savings account. We carried real insurance in case of catastrophe.
Right.
We had insurance and we used our savings account to pay for our health maintenance.
Right.
Just like, you know, if you have a car, you got to, you know, catastrophe's covered.
Yeah.
But you change your own tires and your oil and all that fun stuff.
Yeah, so right now a family can put in around $13,000 for that savings account, which, you know, it's not great, but it's better than what it was. The new proposal lets state keep Medicaid expansions and allows states to expand the Medicaid as they need it. So, you know, dial back, bump it up, whatever.
So the states have more discretion.
Right.
All right.
Anything else? Well, the only thing, we're repealing the cost-sharing subsidy.
So this pretty much means that we're banking on overall costs adjusting down for everyone. No longer will the government pay part of your bill.
Right.
This is going to upset some people.
Right.
Because
not
some
as much as larger companies no longer have to provide affordable insurance or face penalty. That's one of the things that's being repealed now.
Okay. So businesses are not required to supply.
Not carrying the burden anymore.
All right.
Which can be a really good thing, and then some people are going to look at that as a really bad thing. So
so here's the shakedown on the high spots of it. I said on this program that three things had to happen for it to be considered a successful run at repealing and replacing Obamacare, and I said they had to happen quickly. One is that people had to see their costs come down.
Right.
We know immediately their ability to buy certain levels will reduce costs for them.
Right.
To get those costs down will yet to be seen. So that's up in the air.
Right. I think the biggest chatter about that right now is because no one's facing a penalty anymore, no one's going to buy into that. So that might drive prices up for people that are partaking in that and consuming that.
We'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see. That's out. The second thing is people have to maintain their level of care. Now, a lot of the provisions here, pre-existing conditions, a lot of yada, 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 the access to preventative care is still there.
Sure.
If costs maintain or come down, they'll maintain their level of care. And the last, or I said improve, and the last thing is their access had to improve.
Right.
And this appears to improve access.
Right.
Now, the liberals are going to be very angry with businesses not having to supply and with this, you know, the subsidy going away.
Sure.
We know this.
Sure.
They're going to be very upset about that. They're not going to like it. So that's what's going to upset people. Conservatives will kind of be upset that if you include pre-existing conditions, the costs aren't going to quite come down as far as you think, guys.
Right.
It's just not. You can sit there and think it might. It's not.
Mm-hmm.
If as long as you're forcing insurance companies to cover people, forcing them to cover people that they can't hold their pre-existing conditions against.
Yeah.
But if I'm not mistaken, they can charge you more based on age.
Yes, that was the big thing. It says up to 5 times more for the older generations than younger.
So that's concerning. Just like in life insurance, now before everybody goes, oh, no, not the age. This happens in life insurance. The older you get, the higher your risk of mortality and therefore the higher your premium is. With healthcare, the older you get, the higher your risk for ailment.
Mm-hmm.
in healthcare, you know, therefore, how are your premium is.
Right. I would imagine this is probably an attempt to get people to purchase early and young and not necessarily lock in to a rate, but maybe get accustomed to that kind of a payment cycle so it doesn't come as such a shock.
Maybe so. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, oh, we got some good stuff for you. Some controversy from the socials. Right here where we throw in Man Up America, a little bit of pop and a little bit of politics, all in one. You're listening to The Good Dr. Jay Adam with Mitch in the studio.
After I was injured due to the negligence of a careless driver, it mattered to me that I receive the compensation that I was entitled to. When it matters to me, I choose Logan Thompson. Logan Thompson, attorneys at law, when it matters.
My passion is outdoors, but my knees reached a point where I just couldn't enjoy it as well, so I had knee replacement surgery at Tenova. My experience was excellent. My new knees are great. They work well, I have no pain, and I'm able to do all the things that I enjoy.
If joint pain is affecting your life, find out how Tenova can help. Come to a free joint pain seminar. Register today at TenovaOrtho.com.
Jay Adam, have you ever felt kicked in the gut when trying to get approved for a loan or a home mortgage? Then go by and see my friends at Home Mortgage Solutions for a free approval. They don't hand them out like candy and just tell you what you want to hear, but they dig deep to find the solutions you need to get qualified. They have competitive rates, and with over 80 years of experience under one roof, you don't have to go anywhere else. They're never too busy, so just give them a call, 423-339-8086, or visit homemortgagesolutionsllc.com. Jay Adam, have you ever felt kicked in the gut when trying to get approved for a loan or a home mortgage? Then go by and see my friends at Home Mortgage Solutions for a free approval. They don't hand them out like candy and just tell you what you want to hear, but they dig deep to find the solutions you need to get qualified. They have competitive rates, and with over 80 years of experience under one roof, you don't have to go anywhere else. They're never too busy, so just give them a call, 423-339-8086, or visit homemortgagesolutionsllc.com. Jay Adam, have you...
When I was accused of a crime, my liberty was hanging in the balance. My legal rights matter to me, so I went to the professionals at Logan Thompson Law. Logan Thompson, attorneys at law, when it matters.
Stage AVL Audio Visual Design. Experience more from the small stage to the big stage. From sound and lighting and video to projection and acoustical treatment. From festivals and parties to corporate. From system rental to installation. Stage AVL has you covered. For more information, visit stageavl.com or call them at 423-473-9668.
Are you looking for professional flexibility? A way to impact your community? Or just autonomy?
If these are things you want from a career, call Woodman Life today.
423-790-2847.
The good Dr. Jay Adam here, talking to all the gentlemen out there. For those of you with wives, girlfriends, even mothers, which would make all of you, you need to call 423-472-8887 and talk to the good folks at Bliss Day Spa. Nothing says I love you like the special treatment, the VIP treatment of the services of Bliss Day Spa. Call them today, 423-472-8887. Tell them the good doctor sent you from Man Up America. The good doctor, Jay Adam, here, talking to all the gentlemen out there. For those of you with wives, girlfriends, even mothers, which would make all of you, you need to call 423-472-8887 and talk to the good folks at Bliss Day Spa. Nothing says I love you like the special treatment, the VIP treatment of the services of Bliss Day Spa. Call them today, 423-472-8887. Tell them the good doctors.
All right, we're back, and you're listening to Man Up America right here on Talk 101.3 The Buzz, WTNB Television, Charter Channel 5, Comcast 210, Digital TV Dial 27.1. Mitch, during the break, we did have a question from a listener about the old age, the ability to bump premiums.
Right.
The answer to that, the question was this: could they remove the, or could it cost more for people who are not yet old enough for Medicare? And the answer to that question is theoretically yes. We don't know how those companies are going to respond. It just allows them to charge. Keep
right.
in mind that just because somebody can charge, for instance, I could go out tomorrow and I could charge you $1,000 to cut your hair.
Mm-hmm.
If no one's willing to pay me $1,000 to cut their hair,
right.
I'm not going to get $1,000 to cut their hair. So what we've had for so long with healthcare, and this predates Obamacare, this isn't an Obamacare thing, it just got worse under Obamacare, is we've not had a true market to determine pricing.
Right, right.
This and moves so, it back towards that, but I'll tell you, right. as long as we have Medicare reimbursements, we're going to have a false market.
Right. So it says, like, the actual wording on the change is, it says it allows insurers to charge older customers five times as much as younger ones, and give states the options to set their own ratios. So,
well, there you go. You heard it from Mitch right here. Without any further ado, we're getting on time, so let's go. So today on The Turn, this is what we've got. The controversy is afoot, and it does not involve Donald Trump.
No, I know.
Imagine that.
It's about time. Can we all be thankful?
And it is multi-generational.
Right.
If you are young and a fan of everything Disney, you are being berated about whether or not you should go see Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah.
Because Disney has confirmed openly that one of the characters, Gaston's little stooge.
Right.
For those of you who are familiar
does
with the story.
Does he have a name?
He does. It's something French. I don't
okay.
know.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But I don't know the story that well.
Mm-hmm.
I do know Gaston.
Right. Everyone knows Gaston.
Yeah, Gaston. So no mm-hmm. one's next as thick as Gaston.
Right.
You know, it's this great number. He's obviously this antagonist slash male figure in the movie or in the show. And in this live-action drama that they're doing with Beauty and the Beast that's coming out that everyone's very, very excited over, his stooge evidently has some homosexual attraction to him.
Right.
And Disney kind of plays that up in the storyline. Well, the socials have been, oh, my goodness. Oh, I mean, crazy. But it doesn't stop there, Mitch.
Well, I'm scared.
If you are older and you do not have children and you are a fan of the book The Shack, which is a story that is now a movie
right.
about how humans interact with God and this
right.
kind of thing. People are up in arms about it being sacrilegious and distorting the image of God and God's behavior and all this kind of stuff. So we're back again to how mad we can be at Hollywood.
Right, right.
Now, are you surprised at all
no.
about Disney's move with Gaston Stooge?
I don't think so. I don't think that surprises me at all. I think that if you've looked at all of the Disney animated movies, you know, from years ago, there's always been that one thing in there that's like, I don't know. So I don't think that they've ever tried to distance
Tell us those
themselves.
Conspiracy theories there, Mitch. The Disney conspiracy theory.
You know, several.
Like the cover of The Little Mermaid.
The Little Mermaid. And if you look at, you know, several princesses have very difficult relationships with their parents and learning to navigate through those things. It's just, I don't think that all Disney movies are what we make them out to be for our children. So I don't think that this is a very far stretch for them to make. And I would tell people, if you don't like it, don't consume it. It's your choice.
Well, now, I will say that I don't know if this is a man-up moment for me. I think if there's something to man up on, it's the fact that this is nothing new.
Right.
This is nothing new from Hollywood. Disney has stated its very overt support of the LGBTQRAFWCP community.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They've been very verbal about supporting that and finding ways to normalize mm-hmm. that activity mm-hmm. for children at a young age.
Right.
I also understand that how parents can be very adverse to that.
Mm-hmm.
Will we police what our children? And there's this idea that if for some reason, if you guard your children against things like that early on, you're a bad parent because that's the way the world works, and eventually they're going to see it or do it,
right.
yada, yada. Okay,
right.
I get all that. What I'm saying is overt sexual content at a young age, whether heterosexual or homosexual, is not allowed for my children.
It's inappropriate.
Anything that gets through to them is incidental at this point. We are very paced with our children and their rites of passage, in which we have I want to be the first to have that discussion with my child.
Sure.
I don't want it to be prompted by a Disney
right.
movie.
Right.
I don't want to be walking through the lobby, throwing away my popcorn and getting questions about, Daddy, what's a homosexual?
Right.
You know, Daddy, why do boys kiss? Or for that matter, you know, Daddy, what's a makeout session? Or what,
right.
You know,
right.
I don't want to deal with that. I want to deal with that as a parent in my own right. So
right.
it causes me to be vigilant. Will I take my children to see this movie? Probably not when we talk about Beauty and the Beast. I'll probably wait till it comes to Redbox. I'll screen it like I do every other movie for language, for violence, for
right.
all these kind of things.
Right.
And there are times where I yield and allow my children to consume what I feel they're capable of doing. So that's my man up moment for parents. Please just be as vigilant as you would in any other movie. Now, in regards to The Shack, I don't know enough about the story.
Yeah, I don't know.
I haven't read the book.
Is that a Nicholas Sparks book? Is that who that
it's
is?
Something like
I don't
that.
Know.
I probably won't see it until I'm force-fed it by my wife, okay? I'm kind of forgiving to things spiritual in movies because I do not expect Hollywood to be spiritually savvy.
Right.
I don't. I watched the movie about Noah. Was it biblically accurate? I didn't think so. Was it a good movie? I thought it was okay.
Right.
I watched the movie about the Exodus with Christian Bale as a horrible Moses, but it was still a cool movie. To me, I put it in the same category as The Mummy.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Even though the story was biblically based. So I think that there's a level of reason that people have to start bringing to this. Don't be surprised. At the same time, for all you people who want to point and call parents stupid for not taking their kids to see this movie, they're not stupid. There are people who are pushing an agenda on America's youth to socialize or normalize them
sure.
into a culture that some parents are opposed to.
Right.
There are still a big chunk of the American public that say, even though we can be compassionate towards homosexuals, even though we can be sympathetic towards the LGBTQ community,
right.
we still believe that it falls in the realm of social abnormality and disorder.
Right.
And we're compassionate to the point of treatment. There are people who say that. It doesn't make them evil to say that.
Sure.
It doesn't make them evil. We have started slipping and allowing more and more things that are outside the mainstream, and we have to ask ourselves, are we doing a justice to our children to allow them to be exposed to those things at too early of an age?
Right, right. And I think that was a big point of conversation with the bathroom issue is – I understand that you've probably been, this has been happening for quite some time, but my child's not equipped to deal with those things yet, so I don't want it thrown in their face. And this is kind of the same thing.
Well, this is what I said about when we had the whole bathroom fiasco in North Carolina, is, you know, everybody wanted to say, well, predators are now going to be in the women's bathroom. And I'm thinking, usually those predators are after little boys, and they're in that bathroom anyway.
Right.
So it's not a far fetch for us to say that the threat's already there.
Right.
Like you said, most people have been using the bathroom. But yeah, man, an amazing, amazing social media response over the whole issue. And that's why we have this show, a little bit of pop, a little bit of politics, right? To see what's trending on social media. I think that there is a sliver of the U.S. population, maybe even the international population, but I know in the States, because we're still like a Judeo-Christian community, who want to think they can redeem Disney. Disney is a big, big, here comes the word, secular beast.
Right.
It is not a religious beast. There have been alternatives to that for some time, but Disney has never claimed to be, nor is it, a Christian institution at all. It is an institution of entertainment. I think it's a horrible business decision for them to be as overt on some social issues as others. I understand their motivations, but it's still not great for business, right? I do know people who are boycotting Disney. It does cost them money to do that.
It's not the happiest place on earth anymore.
Just like when Chick-fil-A took their stance, people boycotted Chick-fil-A.
And if you're going to have that on both ends of the spectrum, though. For as many people that you have boycott, you're going to have people show their support for business. So, you know, I don't know.
I think
it's just all about being mindful as a consumer that if you don't enjoy something, you don't have to consume it. That's a choice that you make.
Always the truth.
You see something you don't like on social media, you don't have to comment.
That's right. You don't have to watch it. You don't have to watch it at all. All right, so today on the river, to bring us home, Mitch, we're ramping up for the governor's race here in Tennessee. Aren't you happy? Haven't you been waiting for a new governor's race in Tennessee?
This is the thing. I'm going to just admit to you right now that I am not educated on this. So you are going to have to fill me in on the highs and the lows.
Well, here it is. Yesterday, Commissioner of the Department of Economic and Community Development, also known as one of the current governor's flunkies, Randy Boyd, declared his candidacy for governor.
Okay.
So I think he's obviously the heir apparent. So here's my man up moment to you guys out there. Haslam's picked his pony. There it is. It's Randy Boyd. You wanted to know who it was? It's Randy Boyd. Boyd's in the race. So Randy Boyd's in the race. He now joins Mark Green, who's a state senator, who's running for governor on the Republican side. This is the Republican primary. Potential people who've expressed interest are Diane Black, she's a U.S. House of Representatives, Marsha Blackburn, U.S. House of Representatives. There's several females in the Republican ranks who have a possible run at this. Joe Carr, he's a former state representative, and they call him a perennial candidate, but he is.
Okay.
He's run before. Bob Corker, U.S. Senator, is governor.
Okay.
I don't know why Bob would. He's got a lot of power. I don't suspect he'll come over to the governor's race.
Right.
Stephen Fincher, former U.S. House of Representative. Alberto Gonzalez, he's the dean of Belmont University School of Law.
Impressive.
And a former U.S. Attorney General.
Okay.
Remember Attorney General Gonzalez under Bush. Bill Hagerty is a former commissioner of Department of Community and Economic Development. He's the pre-Randy Boyd.
Right.
Beth Hartwell, who's the Speaker of the House in Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
Bill Lee's a businessman. Mark Norris, who's the majority Senate leader in Tennessee. It's actually got him as probable. He came to Cleveland and said in Cleveland he is running for governor.
He's going to do it.
So Mark Norris is running for governor. A couple of others. Andy Ogle, director of Tennessee Chapter of Americans for Prosperity, is a possibility. And Jamie Woodson, former state senator. Trey Haggart, or Hargett, who's the Secretary of State, has declined, and so is Ron Ramsey, former Lieutenant Governor.
Okay.
So there you go. Three on the Republican side that I know of right now is you've got, you definitely have Mark Norris running, Randy Boyd running, and Mark Green.
Right.
So let's see if we can get another Mark in that race.
So it's going to be a contest between those people.
It is.
The
governor's pony is Randy Boyd. Randy Boyd, mark my words, will have a lot of money.
A lot of money.
To run this race. Randy Boyd will have a lot of money.
Do you think that's a good thing or a bad thing? Because I don't know anything about him.
Well, we're not going to pick candidates on this show yet.
Yeah.
Don't put it past me to pick a candidate on this show. They can throw me off the airwaves for all I care. I'm more likely to just let you know personally
right.
through my other outlets who I would support or not support. But no, just the fact that that's obviously, I mean, that's the governor's boy, right?
Yeah.
They're both from, you know, ties to Knoxville.
Right.
And Bill Haslam still has a lot of money and a lot of influence. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. going to go to Randy mm-hmm. Boyd, I think. So what about the Democrats in
Tennessee? They don't have a chance.
Well, before you say that, a lot of people are very excited about Carl Dean. He's the former mayor of Nashville, Music City. Carl Dean's going to run. Potential Gordon Ball, attorney and nominee for the U.S. Senate in 2014. Andy Burke, the mayor of Chattanooga. Jim Cooper, U.S. House of Representatives and a former U.S. Senate candidate. Craig Fitzha is the minority leader. I guess that's how you say Fitzhugh, of the Tennessee House of Representatives. Sarah Kyle, state senator and former director of the Tennessee Regulatory Authority. Ralphie May.
There it is. I've been waiting for this moment.
Ralphie May, stand-up comedian, may run for the Democratic nomination to be governor of Tennessee. For those of you who are not familiar with Ralphie May, former candidate or former contestant on Last Comic Standing, big guy, makes fun of himself for being big. Really funny guy, but obviously off-color comedy.
Right.
And to see his name on that list just made me giggle.
Well, I mean, Donald Trump is our president, so it's not a stretch. It's not a stretch anymore.
It's amazing.
I don't know.
Who else could pop into the equation? We don't know.
I know. I mean, who is it? What is it? Kenny Chesney or Brad Paisley, who's from here? Maybe they could, you know, run.
Half of the country music artist scene live here in Tennessee.
It is what it is.
Kim McMillan, mayor of Clarksville and former state representative. Bill Purcell, former mayor of Nashville.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And Madeline Ruggiero, former mayor of Knoxville. Declined as Bill Freeman, businessman, and was candidate for mayor of Nashville. So it's interesting to watch this race take shape. I think as we get into state and local races in 2018,
mm-hmm.
this program will become a place where we vet some of these folks and we man up on them. Just a warning, if you're a local candidate, if you're a state candidate and you're invited on this show, I hope you come.
Yeah.
But if there's something lingering out there, like, you know, you beat a squirrel one time, I'm going to ask you about if you beat a squirrel.
Right.
We're going to make you deny it on this program. We got hit last week here on Man Up America about Jeff Sessions
mm-hmm.
being accused of communicating with the Russians,
sure.
which Jeff Sessions came out and denied it. Somebody said, and we didn't get into wiretapping, we're going to hit it tomorrow.
Right.
You're going to say that it's possible Obama wiretapped, but you're not going to say it's possible Jeff Sessions talked to the Russians. Jeff Sessions denied it.
Right.
Obama and his people have yet to deny wiretapping.
Right.
Silence speaks volumes sometimes. I've often said, whether it's media or otherwise, if you leave a vacuum, someone will fill it. There's a difference until the Obama administration comes out to me and says, nope, never happened, never wiretapped anybody.
Yeah.
I'm going to take, you know, I can't take him for their word.
Yeah.
I take Jeff Sessions for his word at the moment.
Right.
Because we don't
have any reason not to.
That's right. So we're going to put you on this program if you will come, and we're going to make you deny those things. Mm-hmm. We're also going to talk basically on the issues. We're going to be kind, cordial. And we'll do all those fun things that everybody wants us to do to be good Americans.
It'll be interesting.
That's what we're supposed to do.
Yeah.
That's all we have today. We'll be back tomorrow. Talk 101.3 The Buzz, WTMB Television. Thanks to Bliss Day Spa, Home Mortgage Solutions, Stay at AVL. We had a great show at Tennessee Live this weekend. Tomorrow I'm going to announce the next headliner. I've got Mitch in the studio. I'm the good Dr. Jay Adam. Thanks for being on Man Up America. A little bit of pop, a little bit of politics. That's all we have for today.